Thanks for joining us for CBN News Today. I'm Charlene Aaron.
And I'm Ephraim Graham. Dr. Kent Brantley is giving God all the glory for his recovery from Ebola. Both he and Nancy Reiple are home with their families today. But in West Africa, the deadly virus continues to spread. Operation Blessing is there providing some much-needed help and supplies. Caitlin Burke reports.
After nearly 3 weeks of intense treatment, testing, and isolation, Nancy Reitball and Dr. Kent Brantley are back home with their families.
I'm thrilled to be alive, to be well, and to be reunited with my family.
The Reitball family requests privacy, but made the following statement. During the course of her fight, Nancy recalled the dark hours of fear and loneliness, but also a sense of the deep abiding peace and presence of God, giving her comfort. Both Reitball and Dr. Brantley say they're thankful for all of the prayers on their behalf.
I cannot thank you enough for your prayers and your support. But what I can tell you is that I serve a faithful God who answers prayers.
Doctors say after 3 weeks, Ebola patients who have beaten the disease can't spread the virus because it's no longer in their blood or saliva.
The medical staff here at Emory is confident that the discharge from the hospital of both of these patients poses no public health threat.
Experts say both patients still have some healing ahead, as it's common for fatigue and aches and pains to linger. Reitball and Dr. Brantley were working in the Ebola ward of this field hospital in Liberia when they got sick. And while their treatment was a success, the outbreak in West Africa is far from contained. According to the World Health Organization, the death toll is now at more than 1,300 people. Local governments have put in place a no-touching rule and are going to great lengths to encourage the public to wash their hands with chlorinated water.
The thing, don't hug your wife, don't hold hands with your friend, don't even shake hands with a colleague.
But many of the areas being hit the hardest by Ebola have run out of chlorine. Operation Blessing is on the scene and heard of this need.
I met with the Minister of the Interior of Liberia and asked him what some of his priority needs were. He's heading up the anti-Ebola task force for the nation. And he said his number one need right now was body bags, which is an eye-opening, you know, need, of course. His number two need was chlorine.
OB is sending 5 chlorine-generating units from its Chesapeake, Virginia warehouse. They'll be able to produce a total of 550 gallons of chlorine per day, a major step towards reducing the threat of spreading Ebola. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Operation Blessing is also working with a local hospital in Monrovia, providing medical supplies and other equipment, and working with local churches to educate the public about Ebola. Now, you can find out more about Operation Blessing by going to its website. That is at ob.org.
Missouri Governor Jay Nixon is ordering the withdrawal of the National Guard from Ferguson. The decision comes as tensions seem to be easing after 2 weeks of violent protests over the death of 18-year-old Michael Brown. Authorities have arrested at least 163 people since protests began on August 9th. Nixon says National Guard officers have effectively protected the city while other agencies work to restore trust between law enforcement and residents. Officer Darren Wilson, who shot Brown, is on administrative leave while an investigation is underway.
America's military and intelligence officers are pledging an even greater commitment to striking down the radical Islamic militant group known as ISIS or ISIL. This follows an international effort to track down those who killed American journalist James Foley, and now there are threats to kill Stephen Sotloff. He is the second American journalist being held hostage.
We are pursuing a long-term strategy against ISIL because ISIL clearly poses a long-term threat.
We'll work with our law enforcement, our intelligence, and our military partners to try to bring justice to the Foley family and bring the full force of the United States to bear on these savages.
The White House also released and defended details of an unsuccessful mission to rescue several Americans in Syria last month. ISIS had demanded $130 million in ransom for James Foley, but the U.S. refused to consider it.
ISIS is not only trying to terrorize Americans by killing Foley, they're also trying to stoke fear from inside the U.S. The last week has brought a photo tweet from an ISIS supporter in front of the White House and even a pro-ISIS banner at the Ferguson riots. But the danger may be more than just about a PR war. Texas Governor Rick Perry is just one of many who fears that ISIS terrorists could have entered the U.S. through our porous southern border.
There is, I think, great concern that the border between the United States and Mexico is unsecure, and we don't know who's using that. What I will share with you that we've seen historic high levels of individuals from countries with terrorist ties over the course of the last months. Individuals from ISIS or other terrorist states could be, and I think it's a very real possibility that they may have already used that.
A number of U.S. lawmakers in Washington have also warned that U.S. citizens have gone to fight for ISIS and could bring their terror training back to the U.S.
Hamas killed 11 suspected Israel informers today as Israeli airstrikes and Hamas rockets fire continue for a third day in a row. A Gaza security official says the killings come in response to Israel's airstrikes on a house that killed three Hamas leaders. The 11 informants were killed at a Gaza City police headquarters. Hamas has vowed revenge for the targeting of its leaders. More than 2,600 people have died during the attacks since July 8th.
Bank of America has reached a $17 billion settlement with federal and state authorities over the sale of mortgage securities leading up to the 2008 financial crisis. It is the latest and biggest action yet between the government and big banks. But as Paul Strand reports, some critics say these settlements don't really help the financial system at all.
To dodge threats of civil or criminal trials, banks are paying huge fines for their supposed financial sins that helped bring the economy low in the 2008 crash, even if they didn't commit those sins themselves. For instance, take the case of J.P. Morgan Chase. They had to pay $13 billion in a settlement with the Justice Department. That amounted to half a year's earnings, and it was the largest penalty ever paid by an American firm up until then. But critics say J.P. Morgan Chase wasn't even involved in most of what the government called misconduct. Most of the misdeeds were perpetrated by Bear Stearns and Washington Mutual. The government went to Morgan and asked it to take over those two failing banks. Then years later, went after Morgan for what those two banks did.
It was a shotgun wedding where the New York Fed said, please take Bear Stearns. And then to turn around and say, well, you know, you're responsible now legally for what Bear Stearns did. We're going to take it out of your shareholders.
And now the federal government is saying, by the way, you're going to have to pay penalties for what those banks did, the very same banks we insisted that you buy.
I think that is just a horrible message. It means that in any future financial crisis, the healthier banks are going to say, I don't want anything to do with this.
Kirpin says Bank of America is in the same situation as Morgan, paying for the sins of another bank it bought when pushed.
You look at Bank of America, they didn't issue those countrywide loans. They bought countrywide afterwards.
And the Justice Department has gone after other banks as well. You've seen Citibank's? Their company, Citigroup, is coughing up $7 billion.
This is a witch hunt against a lot of these banks that were not necessarily the bad actors in the first place. Why are we going after we should go after the sinners, not the people who are trying to, have a recovery for our economy.
The question is, why is the Justice Department doing this? What do they have to gain? Some critics say the administration is trying to placate critics who argue the justice had to go after the major banks for their actions before the crisis in 2008. But others have blasted the Justice Department. A Wall Street Journal editorial called Justice's settlement with J.P. Morgan Chase last November the Morgan shakedown and said the lesson is how government has used the crisis to exert political control over even the most powerful private financial companies. An Investor's Business Daily editorial called it another mugging on Wall Street. And a columnist for Time magazine wrote that the Morgan settlement does absolutely nothing to make the financial system safer. Officials appear more concerned about appeasing anger over the financial crisis than doing the harder and more politically contentious work of re-regulating the banking system properly. And Kirpin agrees Justice's actions aren't really helping matters, but he says they are hurting the economy. Because banks are so frozen in fear, they're leery of loaning money. Instead, they're saving up billions in case they have to pay fines in the future.
It's very difficult to get loans, and that has a very negative impact on the economy, not just in housing, but across the economy, because small businesses in particular are finding it very difficult to get financing right now.
Now, all of the banking system has this hammer over its head, which is the federal government and the Justice Department coming after them for activities that many of the banks weren't even involved in. So I don't think it's fair. I don't think it's good economics. And I think it's an abuse of the power of the federal government.
Paul Strand, CBN News, Washington.
Coming up, gay activists target their next victim, how they're forcing farmers to allow same-sex weddings on their property. A New York couple faces thousands of dollars in fines for declining to rent out their family farm for a same-sex wedding. The New York State Division of Human Rights fined Cynthia and Robert Gifford $13,000.
That's right. The couple believes marriage is the union of one man and one woman. For more on this case, Mark Martin spoke with Ryan Anderson from the Heritage Foundation.
In 2012, Ryan, a lesbian couple asked the Giffords to rent the family's barn for their wedding ceremony and reception. Cynthia Gifford said she and her husband could not, in good conscience, host the event, believing that as free citizens running a business, they should have the right to decline to participate in an event that does not reflect their values. Do you agree?
Oh, yes. I mean, part of the landmark of America's achievement as a free society was that people, when they step into the marketplace, could bring their moral and religious values with them. And so part of the genius of free markets, free contracts, free association, the freedom of speech, and the free exercise of religion was that we didn't have to leave behind all of our beliefs, all of our values, when we engaged in public life. And so the logic here would be that they can run their family farm and host the type of weddings that they believe are in accordance with their values, and that the same-sex couple can seek out a different venue for their wedding ceremony. Unfortunately, New York State has passed a non-discrimination statute that says that you can't discriminate on the basis of sexual orientation or gender identity, and that believing that marriage is the union of a man and a woman then constitutes that illegal discrimination. The problem here is that New York State's created special privileges on the basis of sexual orientation and gender identity, and has done this at the expense of fundamental civil rights like freedom of association, free contract, and free exercise of religion.
How can that be? I mean, to me, that does not make any sense that the special privileges override the religious freedom of the owners.
Well, we'll see how this gets litigated. You know, the family has hired an attorney, and they're going to appeal the ruling of the Human Rights Commission. But frequently what's taken place here is that in the name of equality or in the name of non-discrimination, real fundamental civil liberties have been discarded. What we could see here is a live and let live society in which business people who are in favor of same-sex marriage would provide their services for same-sex weddings, and business people who do not favor same-sex marriage would be free to offer their services to the weddings that they believe in, the union of a man and a woman, a husband and a wife. We don't need to have the government impose a one-size-fits-all solution here. So what's ironic is that the people who have been talking the loudest about live and let live and freedom to live and to love are the very same people who then want to impose their values through the coercive government onto this family farm.
All right, Ryan Anderson of the Heritage Foundation, thank you so much for your time and your insights today, sir.
Happy to be with you.
Up next, we're going behind the scenes of the new movie, When the Game Stands Tall.
He took over a high school football program that had never won a single game. Then for the next 12 years, his teams never lost a game, leading to a world record of 151 consecutive wins.
Unbelievable. A new movie about this legendary coach opens in theaters today. It starts, though, with game 152, when this phenomenal winning streak came to a stunning halt. De La Salle High School owns a high school football record, 12 years without ever losing a game. But you won't find any signs boasting about it at the California Catholic School. And that's the mark of the team's mild-mannered and modest leader, Bob Lattiser, who began coaching the Spartans in 1979.
Coach, when you signed on to teach religious studies at the school and then signed on to be coach, the team had never won a game. What made you say yes to the job?
I was young, and I was 24 at the time, and I thought, I'm going to give this a shot and see what I can do. And I was even trying to seek my own level of competence or what I was meant to do, because I really didn't know. And I thought this might be it. I mean, I felt real comfortable about football. I had a good feel for the game, and I thought, let's give it a shot. And once I got into it, it only took me a year, and I thought, this is what I'm meant to do.
Coach Ladd's perfect 151-game record produced NFL stars like Maurice Jones-Drew, DJ Williams, and TJ Ward. It's a winning record that inspired a book, and now a movie.
Come on, Bob, you turned this team into a winning machine. How long do you think you can keep the streak alive?
The streak was never our goal.
But when the game stands tall begins with game 152, when the winning streak ends and things fall apart for the coach and his team, on and off the field.
DNA! Call 911!
Actor Jim Caviezel plays the coach, a role he admits is tough, with real-life players and Coach Ladd fans watching to see if he nails it.
It's been said of the Coach Ladd role that whoever played that role would have to plunge himself into the toughest year of a complicated man's life. What was the challenge for you in that role?
Normally, when you do a script, you have just the foundation of the script that you're working on. This one, there's another one, and that's him. And then who are we going to get to play Terry? That was a, this is an odd couple, and this is a very, there were a lot of things that could go wrong that didn't go wrong.
Terry Edson is Coach Ladd's animated assistant.
Hey, we don't do that here. Reporters, friends, family, strangers, they're all gonna ask the same thing. What happened? This is a question that's gonna follow you. How did you lose the streak?
Played by actor Michael Chiklis.
I mean, naturally, they want to win the games they play, but really what they want to accomplish is mentoring these boys into young men who can be relied upon.
Break it up!
The De La Salle Spartans story is tougher off the field with real-life player Cameron Colvin. He lost both parents before his sophomore year, and that was only the beginning of his pain. His best friend and teammate is shot and killed just 2 days before they were to leave together for college.
People always ask me what it's like to never lose. Today I am lost.
Sedarius Blaine plays the role of Cameron.
What is it about him you think that allows him to push through hell on earth, essentially?
Support, brotherhood.
Yeah.
That's it. You know, he has the support of 60 brothers on one football team. Who won't let him fall into despair.
That is the message of the movie, is that I think, you can't do it alone. You need to have the strength to depend on someone. And that's sometimes the hardest thing to do, is to actually ask somebody for help.
This is a football film about a modest man dedicated to raising mighty men.
This film, many people watching it left in tears. What is it about the story you think that has people crying watching a football film?
Because it's about kids, and it's about their lives, and it's about, them navigating through life and learning. And we've been fortunate. We get to see that every year, and we've cried our own tears in real time.
I think redemption always brings a tear.
Now be sure to check out the 700 Club Facebook page, where Scott Ross brings us an interview with Jim Caviezel, the star of When the Game Stands Tall. Stay with us. We're coming right back. The weekend is here, and it is time for our regular family-friendly movie reviews. And joining us now with more is Bob Waliszewski, director of Focus on the Family's Entertainment Review Department, called Plugged In Online. So, Bob, let's start with a new drama called If I Stay. It's rated PG-13. How is it to you?
If I Stay is a teen love story from about a 16-year-old excellent cello player and a teen boy who fronts a garage band. The girl, her name is Mia, almost dies early in the film in a traffic accident, and she has this out-of-body experience where we flash back to probably about the last year of her life. Meanwhile, she's trying to decide, we learn in this movie, it's up to her, whether she wants to go to the great beyond someplace or come back to planet Earth and live again. There is some pretty good messages in this film. For instance, there's one about sacrifice. Unfortunately, the teen boy in this film, his name is Adam, certainly doesn't sacrifice as he's scaling her house to sneak in her bedroom. And he's certainly not sacrificing his raging hormones, which is really sad. He puts pressure on her to drink as well. It's the kind of guy that we'd probably want to get a restraining order for. I realize that's not how the director sees it, but that's how most of us would see a guy of this type. I gave this film a mere 2 out of 5 for family friendliness.
All right. Now, before the break, we heard about the story behind the new Jim Caviezel movie, When the Game Stands Tall. What'd you think of it?
I'm just going to add my 2 cents and say we gave this one a 4.5 out of 5. It is an entertaining and engaging sports movie. This true story about Bob Lattiser and his 151 football game winning streak is interesting, to say the least. I think our viewers are going to enjoy this one. And again, very family friendly.
Indeed. Now, Bob, we know that you gave that one, as you just said, a 4.5 out of 5. But there's been a steady stream of family friendly films lately, correct?
I am happy to report the answer to that question is yes. Last week, Walden Media's film, The Giver, came out. We gave it a 4.5 out of 5 as well. A couple weeks ago, The 100-Foot Journey came out, and we gave that one not quite a 4.5, but we gave it a 4. So I can think of 3 strong choices for family this weekend. It's been a while since I've been able to say that.
And that is good news. All right. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you, Ephraim.
Good news indeed. Mm-hmm. Well, that's it for now on CBN News Today. You can find more of our exclusive coverage of the issues you care most about at cbnnews.com.
Tell us what you think about the stories you've seen here today. You can do it on Facebook or at CBN News on Twitter. Hope you'll join us again right here next time. Have a fabulous Friday and a wonderful weekend.